Good morning.
Good morning.
My name is Catherine Luria, and I'm today's service associate. Reverend Matt Alspaugh will be presenting our message this morning.
Good morning, everybody.
Today I'd like to introduce somebody who's well known around Lakeside and has done her own cabaret shows and things like that.
Concerts.
Yeah, concerts. So here today to not only lead in the singing, in the hymns, but also to sing two wonderful songs. And the first one is called I Believe, which was made famous by Andrea Bocelli, written by Eric Levisalis. Here is Christy Caldwell.
Yay. Thank you.
Laugh of children in a world
Our opening words this morning are by Peggy Clark, a Unitarian Universalist minister. Easter is a holiday of miracles. It is life from death, joy from sorrow, celebration from mourning. Easter reminds us that all is never lost, that the story continues as long as we are here to tell it. So gather up your worries. We're going to bury them beneath the ground and watch them transform into flowers of hope, pushing through the earth, reminding us on Easter morning that love brings us back to life, calls us from sadness, from grief, from anxiety, into a world renewed and alive and filled with joy once again. Now, our announcements were on a slideshow at the beginning of the service and were also sent out by email yesterday with the order of service for today. If you are new and would like to receive our emails for upcoming services, please talk to a member of the welcome team or write to us at info@lakechapalauu.org. And now a special welcome to our visitors. If you are visiting for the first time or have returned for or reconnected with us after a long absence, we invite you to say your name and tell us where you're from. If you're on Zoom, use the Zoom raise hand feature and we'll ask you to unmute. If you are in the room, just raise your hand.
Is this on? Yeah, great.
Hi, my name is Kathy, and I live here in Rebatis.
Oh, excellent.
Hi, I'm Sharon, and I'm from Michigan, and I'm here until May 7th.
Excellent. Welcome. And
yes.
Hi, I'm Natasha Beery. I'm Colleen's sister, visiting from Berkeley, California.
Welcome. And I didn't see you over here.
Hi, I'm Susan Payne, and I live in Cape Elizabeth, Maine, which is near Portland, and I'm visiting my brother, Tom.
Excellent. Welcome. Others here in the room? And perhaps any on Zoom?
Not on Zoom today.
Okay.
And just a brief note, we offer a wide variety of services on various topics, presented by our members, outside guests, as well as our minister, Reverend Matt Alspaugh. We hope you will return to sample this variety of thought and belief. Our chalice lighting words today are by Dilman Baker Sorrells. For holy days on which we recall the old stories, we light the flame. For Passover, which reminds us of the courage and strength of those seeking freedom from the past, we light the flame. For Easter, which reminds us that love is our greatest challenge, we light the flame. For gathering today in this sacred space, we light the flame. For the opportunity to be together as a community, to remember the past, to plan for our future, to be alive in our present, we light this flame. Now let us sing these words together.
We kindle this light in celebration for the
There are many ways to be of service.
Kindle this night in celebration for the life that we share.
There are many ways to be of service to LCUUF. Our time, treasure, and talents are all necessary components to a healthy fellowship. Now is the time in our service when we ask you to share the gift of treasure through pledging and donations. Instructions for payments to the fellowship are on our website. For people here at the fellowship, we'll pass a basket. If you are new here today, or you are struggling to hold things together, let the basket pass you by. Your presence is more than enough and is a gift to us. And while you are considering your gifts to the fellowship, remember that each month, LCUUF donates 5,000 pesos or more to an organization in our Lakeside community. We share one half of the offering collected at the fellowship each week for that organization. For the month of April, we will be supporting Poco a Poco, which helps people in the San Pedro Itzigan area. This organization supports youth and women in this indigenous area through education, teaching local organic food growth, providing food and drinking water to renal patients, feeding over 300 children 5 days a week, offering health service as well as literacy and English as a second language. Our opening hymn is Lo, the Earth Awakens Today. Oh dear. Oh, there's more.
Oh, there's more. Yeah. So this hymn, we added this like last night, is by Samuel Longfellow. Some of you may recognize that name. He was a Unitarian minister and the brother to the poet Henry Wadsworth Longfellow. Now, the tune is called Easter Hymn. We'll get familiar with that today. It was written in 1708. Please rise in body or spirit and join us in singing.
Each week we wait for the bells. Okay. Each week, we take time to remind ourselves that we belong to a community which cares for each other. The sharing of joys, sorrows, and milestones is one way that we practice holding one another in community. We speak what is in our hearts, sharing any significant joys or sorrows in our lives, because there is power in the sharing. We will start with the folks in the room to give those on Zoom a chance to type joys or sorrows into the chat to be read out loud by the Zoom host. First, let us recall the joys. Whatever you may be celebrating, whatever evokes a feeling of joy or peace for yourself or others. Are there any joys that people would like to share in the room?
Okay, we'll start in the front.
Hi, everybody. I'm really happy to be here today, and I'm very happy that my partner, Adrian, is home after many weeks away working. The other thing, really good news we had is I only do concerts for fundraising. Mama Cleo's Boys Home now has a permanent home. And I think you contribute, right? Well, they've been moving house to house for several years, and some people got together and bought them a house. It's in San Nicolas, so anybody wants to go visit. It needs remodeling, but that's really a joy for me.
Okay. Phyllis.
Hi, I'm organizing a fundraiser for next week, and it's going to be held at Estacion. It's a huge event. It's a beautiful event. It's free for the public and lots of samples, and we're going to raise money for an animal shelter that just started in Mescala, and it's called Ma, which is Me Ayuda. Yes. And it's April 15th, and it's at Estacion on top of top side of Pancho's, right. Thank you.
Great. You can talk to Phyllis after about this. Yeah.
Hi, I'm Sharon and Steve, and we had our first grandchild born last week.
Okay. Oops, sorry.
My name is Paul Bennett. Paula and I are very happy to be celebrating our 5th anniversary.
Okay, coming around the backside.
Hi, I'm Annie. Anybody who knows me knows I can't sit still, and I had foot surgery, and it's very disobedient, so it's going a little bit slower, but I'm so grateful for the folks here and in the area who, I mean, what a wonderful bunch of people, just so much love and support, so thank you.
Oh, wonderful. Okay. Great.
Hi, I'm June Wilson, and this week I was the official counter, and I think we might have a record, 59 people. I counted twice.
Oh, thank you.
Just
in the room.
There's more people on Zoom.
And if that's all in the room, off to Zoom, right?
Are there any joys that people would like to share from Zoom?
Apparently not, but there's 23 of us on.
Wow. That is a joy. Now let us voice our sorrows. Whatever you or the world may be holding that is in need of our healing and caring thoughts. Are there any sorrows people would like to share here in the room?
Okay.
Easter is a very emotional time for me. It was on April 10th in 1991 that my handicapped daughter passed away.
My name is Sue. I hope I would like you to keep my sister-in-law Lori in your thoughts as you may remember, she has pancreatic cancer, stage 4. She has been living a fairly normal life with the help of chemo for the last 18 months. However, she is back in the hospital this weekend with very serious complications.
I'd like to light a candle for Karen Carpenter, who's undergoing radiation again.
There's never joy without sorrow, and it's not a terrible sorrow, but I would like to ask you to help heal my hearing, which I lost in December with an ear infection, and I had the tubes put in last week, and I thought I would hear perfectly after, so it's very hard to hear, but if you keep me in your thoughts and prayers, thank you.
Our beloved cat, Lola, is dying.
Are there any sorrows to be shared on Zoom?
No sorrows today.
And this candle from our care team represents the joys and sorrows we hold in the silent sanctuary of our hearts. We light this candle for all those unspoken sorrows and joys. Let us share a moment of silence to hold in our hearts both the sorrows and the joys that have been shared this morning.
Today is Easter, a big day, the biggest day in the annual cycle of the Christian holidays. Since both our Unitarian and our Universalist forebears were Christian, it's good for us to acknowledge this day. And yet, Easter is a complex holiday for a lot of people, and especially many of us as Unitarian Universalists. I know a lot of traditional Christian pastors and priests put a lot of time into preparing for Holy Week. There's Palm Sunday and then Maundy Thursday and Good Friday and Easter, perhaps with a few other holy days thrown in between. It's a lot of work and it's tiring, my friends say. As one minister friend said, speaking about Jesus Christ, he said, every year it's the same. We got to get him up, get him down, get him up. So let's talk a little bit about that theology, especially that third step, the get him up, the resurrection on Easter morning. In traditional Christianity, Christ's resurrection was essential for the salvation, the saving of humanity from eternal damnation, because, after all, we humans were inherently sinful. In order to resolve this sinfulness problem and atone humanity with God, Christ had to be sacrificed. Now, the devil's in the details, so to speak. In fact, that is true in one of these theories, in the early Catholic Church, in which Christ gave his own life as ransom to the devil, to Satan, in order to atone humanity from sin. This is the so-called ransom theory of atonement. Now, there's another theory, is that God is wrathful and angry at the sins of humanity and demands punishment. Christ takes a hit for humanity by dying on the cross, and this is the so-called penal substitution theory of atonement. It's very popular among conservative Protestants. Admittedly, there are numerous other theories, such as satisfaction theory of atonement, governmental theory of atonement, recapitulation theory of atonement, among others. I'm not going to go into these today. I'll just note that the various Christian denominations have fought over these theories for centuries. Many of us here find these various theories of atonement highly problematic. First, most of us reject the idea that we are born with original sin and therefore must be saved in the first place. Secondly, we're troubled by the idea that some people are fortunate enough to hear the message to be saved and go to heaven, while others never even get the chance. And thirdly, we observe that these theologies of atonement led many Christians to violence and pogroms against Jews. The theologies also bolstered colonial oppression and violence against non-Christian people around the world. Not such a pretty story when you look closely. But there are other approaches. The early Unitarian Christians also had their own theory of atonement. One of these Unitarians, Faustus Socinus, was an Italian humanist and Renaissance theologian. He asserted that Jesus was a human being, not God, and that Jesus was so passionate about his beliefs in God that he was willing to die for those beliefs, to be a martyr. In Socinus' mind, Jesus was a moral example for all of us. Hence, this is called the moral example theory of atonement. Our Universalist forebears also saw Jesus as a human being, a great spiritual teacher, and for them, the crucifixion and the resurrection weren't that important, since all humanity, every one of us, is already saved by a truly loving God. Everyone is already atoned. Now, another more recent view, I'll just throw this one in, is that Jesus' death on the cross symbolized an act of ultimate defiance against the oppression of the Roman Empire. Jesus was crucified, after all, during Passover week, which itself celebrated Jewish escape to freedom from Egyptian oppression. So Jesus could be seen as one in a long line of social justice warriors seeking freedom and justice for his people. But many of us here likely don't find the story of Jesus particularly compelling. Many of us likely do not find the various theologies of salvation believable, but there are other interpretations of the Easter season that don't require Jesus. For example, the very word Easter comes from Estra, or Ostra, Ostara, which are respectively the Saxon and German goddesses of spring. Thus, some find pagan Easter, with its bunny rabbits and eggs, symbolic of fertility, rebirth, the coming of spring. Easter connects us with a pagan world rich with life, growth, and hope. And then again, leaving religious tradition aside, most of us can connect around the idea that this is a season of rebirth, of growth, of brown turning to green. Spring is springing even here in Mexico, though it is more subtle than up north. Excuse me. Certain trees are already greening on the mountains. The jacaranda trees are covered in purple. Flowers are blooming. And the chicharras, the rainbirds, are singing for the wet season to come. We are in a time of hope, of possibility, waiting for the cooling rains of late spring and summer. So Easter has many meanings, it's true. Here's the thing. We aren't required to choose just one and reject the others. We can pick and choose among these meanings, mixing together the ones we like, the ones that make sense for us. And there's a technical term for this kind of theological mixology, syncretism. Syncretism is the merging and assimilation of things from various faiths, from different religious traditions. We see syncretism in action here in Mexico when the Catholic Church assimilates indigenous ideas into the symbols of the Catholic faith. The Virgin Guadalupe, Dia de los Muertos, even the indigenous symbols like suns and moons on Christian crosses. All of these are syncretic combinations of Catholic and indigenous religious items. So later on in this service, we're going to get syncretic too. Shortly, we're going to share a chocolate communion, taking chocolate, that gift of the ancient Mesoamericans, and combining it with the idea of that communal feast or meal. Now, as far as I know, the chocolate communion is a uniquely Unitarian Universalist ritual creation. It may have even started here in Mexico at the Spanish language congregation Libre Congregación Unitaria in Mexico City. I simply love that the chocolate communion is syncretic, combining various ideas from diverse sources. Like our views of Easter, it's a mixture, a combination. So enjoy the communion as a reminder that we have no specific set of beliefs, no creeds that we all must follow, but rather that we are each invited to find our own ways in our beliefs, mixing and matching, perhaps creating our own. Thus, we create our own spirituality, we construct our own spirituality, and thus we each grow. And before the meditation, I forgot to mention earlier that you on Zoom, and I think this may have been in an announcement, might want to scrounge up a little bit of chocolate if you have some in your house so that you can celebrate with us, or some kind of alternative food if you would prefer. And now we'll just have a little time of silent meditation, a couple of minutes, to just relax, to find our centers, and be together in this space. Let us come back into this time and space to be together again. So today's reading is by Reverend Peter Morales, who was president of the Unitarian Universalist Association of the USA from 2009 until 2017. Now, by way of disclosure, I note that he was also my minister when I was a lay leader in our congregation in Golden, Colorado. The reading was written by Peter in Spanish. Mario will read sections in Spanish, and I will offer the English translation of those sections.
Lo que yo llamo espiritualidad implica todo lo que soy, mi corazón, mi cabeza, mi cuerpo, mi atención. Hay una integridad y armonía maravillosa que tiene que ver con este estado que llamo espiritual.
What I call spirituality involves all of me, my heart, my head, my body, my awareness. There is a wonderful wholeness and harmony about that state I call spiritual.
Hay una dulce serenidad, un sentido de pertenencia, de entrega, de claridad, de alegría, de paz, de estar vivos. La raíz de la palabra espiritual es, después de todo, la misma palabra para aliento o soplo.
There is a sweet serenity, a sense of belonging, of surrender, of clarity, of joy, of peace, of alivement, of aliveness. The root of the spirit, the word spirit, after all, is the same as the word for breath.
Una espiritualidad digna de ese nombre implica una conciencia profunda. Es ese sentido de apertura profunda y de despertar en la tradición budista.
A spirituality worthy of the name involves deep awareness. It is that sense of profound openness and awakening in the Buddhist tradition.
Una espiritualidad verdadera también implica todo lo que somos. Incluye nuestro intelecto, nuestras emociones, nuestros sentidos. Es el estremecimiento agridulce de una noche invernal límpida, de un ocaso amarillo, del aire salado en la playa.
A true spirituality also involves our whole lives. It includes our intellect, our emotions, our senses. It is the bittersweet chill of a clear winter night, the yellow sunset, and salt air in the seashore.
Es quedarse contemplando los cielos, poseídos de un temor reverente. Es la música que pasa sobre nosotros, una música que sentimos, tanto como la escuchamos. Es cantar juntos.
It is staring, awestruck, into the heavens. It is music that washes over us, music that we feel as much as we hear. It is singing together.
Es el abrazo de amante. Es el apretón de una mano infantil. Es el sabor del agua de la montaña, del vino, del chocolate. La espiritualidad es sensual.
It is the embrace of a lover, the clasp of a child's hand. It is the taste of mountain water, of wine, of chocolate. Spirituality is sensual.
La espiritualidad también es una elegante prueba matemática, el nuevo entendimiento ganado en un experimento científico. Es el grito de gozo en una reunión, reír en compañía de buenos amigos, estar presente en el nacimiento y en la muerte.
Spirituality is also an elegant mathematical proof, an insight gained in a scientific experiment. It is a cry for, it is crying for joy at a reunion, laughing with good friends, being present at birth and death.
Es sentirse amados y ser amorosos.
It is feeling loved and being loving.
A little bit shorter.
And I'm joined by Doug Mattoon. We believe this reflection is written by Francis Xavier Lagunas Gaitan, the founder of the Unitarian Congregation in Mexico City. Doug will read the Spanish and I will read the English.
No es ninguna casualidad que el nombre científico del chocolate, Teobama Cacao, signifique alimento de los dioses. Así lo clasificó el gran naturalista Carolus Linnaeus.
It is no coincidence that the scientific name of chocolate, Theobroma Cacao, means food of the gods, as the great naturalist Carolus Linnaeus classified it.
Tiene hondas raíces en la cultura mexicana. Cacao es una palabra maya, de fuego, y chocolate, una palabra náhuatl, agua amarga. Los antiguos sabían que el chocolate es mágico, fuego y a la vez agua.
It has deep roots in Mexican culture. Cacao is the Mayan word of fire, and chocolate is the Nahuatl word bitter water. The ancients knew that chocolate is magical, fire and water at the same time.
El chocolate fue un regalo del héroe cultural Quetzalcóatl Kukulcán para aliviar el cansancio, vigorizar y deleitar el reposo humano. Los mayas consideraban que el cacao los alimentaba más allá de la vida, de la muerte.
Chocolate was a gift from the cultural hero Quetzalcóatl Kukulcán to relieve fatigue, invigorate, and delight human rest. The Mayans considered that cacao nourished them beyond death.
Los monjes españoles le añadieron azúcar y leche, y su uso fue muy popular entre el clero, porque lo consideraban tan espiritual que tomar el chocolate no rompía el ayuno.
Spanish monks added sugar and milk to it, and its use was very popular among the clergy because they considered it so spiritual that eating the chocolate did not break the fast.
Durante un siglo, su elaboración fue un secreto de estado celosamente guardado por la corona española. Hasta 1853, el gobierno británico cobraba un impuesto de las tres cuartas partes del peso del chocolate en oro.
For a century, its preparation was a state secret, closely guarded by the Spanish government. The British government, until 1853, charged a tax of 3/4 of the weight of chocolate in gold.
We will now bless this chocolate, which we will share with this benediction, these good words. And let's see here. We're going to have to.
Bendita sea la tierra generosa que dio al mundo su fruto el cacao, agua y fuego, amargo y dulce, divino regalo para la humanidad. Bendito sea el trabajo del campesino que lo sembró y cosechó. Bendita sea la labor del obrero que la elaboró.
Blessed be the generous land that gave the world its fruit, cocoa, and water and fire, bitter and sweet, a divine gift for humanity. Blessed be the work of the farmer who sowed and reaped it. Blessed be the work of the worker who processed it.
Que al compartir juntos este sagrado fruto de la tierra, recordemos el misterio del amor, ese amor dulce y sencillo de la caricia y de las palabras suaves, y del amor amargo que nos es difícil pasar, el amor duro que ayuda a crecer, pone límites y expresa integridad.
That by sharing the sacred fruit of the earth together, we remember the mystery of love, sweet and easy love of caresses and soft words, the bitter love that is difficult for us to swallow, hard love that helps us to grow, sets limits, and expresses integrity.
Que sea este alimento que compartimos una señal de que entendemos que la buena vida comienza a partir de la aceptación de quienes realmente somos. Somos nosotros mismos y también nosotras relacionamientos. Y que este banquete de vida renueve nuestro compromiso personal y comunitario con el amor y la justicia, por hoy y por todos los días de nuestras vidas.
Let this food that we share be a sign that we understand that the good life starts from accepting who we really are. We are ourselves and our relationships. And may this banquet of life renew our personal and community commitment to love and justice for this and for all the days of our life.
Oh, alma de la humanidad, hijos e hijas de la tierra, que sea nuestra comunión un testimonio de agradecimiento al universo. Que así sea. Amén. Shalom. Namaste.
O soul of humanity, sons and daughters of the earth, let our communion be a testimony of gratitude to the universe. So be it. Amen. Shalom. Namaste. Now we have one poem and then we celebrate.
This poem is called Web and is by Denise Levitan.
Intrigada e inextricable, tejiendo y entretejiéndose, hebras oscuras con claras, diseñada más allá de cualquier estratagema de la araña, para vincular, no atrapar, euforia, tristeza, alegra y contrición entrelazadas, agitada, cambiante, siempre formando y transformándose. Alabemos todos, alabemos la gran tela de toda la existencia.
Intricate and untraceable weaving and interweaving, dark strand with light, designed beyond all spiderly contrivance to link, not to entrap, elation, grief, joy, contrition, entwined, shaking, changing, forever forming, transforming, all praise to the great web.
We'll now share in the Comunión de Chocolate. If you're at home, I invite you to take up your chocolate or other celebratory food. Here we'll pass baskets of chocolate, and we invite you to take one of these. When we're done passing the basket, then let's consume this gift of the gods, slowly, mindfully, taking a moment to savor the flavor. And as we partake, let us reflect on the goodness of our lives and reaffirm our commitment to love and justice to make this world a better place for everyone. So our closing hymn is Jesus Christ is Risen Today. This hymn is by Charles Wesley, a prolific hymn writer who wrote some 6,500 hymns. Now, it probably helped that his brother was John Wesley, who was the founder of Methodism. The tune will be familiar, Easter hymn. So please rise in body and spirit and join us in singing. And so on this Easter morning, may our taste of chocolate remind us that there is no one right way to celebrate Easter, that this day has an ancient, rich, and complex origin, and the meaning of the day really has multiple meanings, meanings which we can explore and embrace or leave behind, for that is our freedom as thinking, feeling, spiritual beings. May it be so.
We extinguish this flame, but not the light of truth, the warmth of community, or the fire of commitment. These we keep in our hearts and share with all the world.
Our worship is over, our service begins. Please go in peace and with a purpose.